for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, follow us on Facebook, check out our YouTube channel, listen to our podcasts, and keep up to date with all of our projects at ruthinstitute.org. Dr. J is a guest of Father Robert McTeague on The Station of the Crosses, The Catholic Current. They're discussing the American Medical Association's push to remove sex from birth certificates.
I'm a humanities major. I'm not a scientist. I'm exhorted to follow the science. And the American Medical Association, by definition, is full of scientists. And the American Medical Association is now asking that we remove acknowledgement of sex from birth certificates. This isn't just a few people acting out and being crazy. This actually has tremendous significance. To help us unpack that issue, my returning guest is a well-known writer. She's founder of the Ruth Institute, author of the important book called The Sexual State, Dr. Jennifer Roebuck-Morse. Welcome back to The Catholic Current.
Thanks for having me, Father.
Dr. Morse, did you ever fall asleep wondering, you know, it's not impossible that tomorrow morning the American Medical Association is going to suggest we no longer acknowledge male and female on birth certificates? That never happened to me. How about you?
I was not ready for that. Well, I mean, once it happened, I wasn't surprised, sadly. But anticipate such a thing? Dream such a thing? No, couldn't do it.
So the question becomes, What happens to people? I mean, these are people who've studied bodies for a long time. I mean, they've got the parts memorized. They know how they fit together. they can draw diagrams.
And you know, I couldn't do that. I get creeped out by anatomy and sick people and so on. So I give the doctors a lot of credit, but what are they thinking? It's sad, but the reality is that many, if not most, of the professions have become completely dominated by ideology. Mm-hmm. And the American Medical Association was really one of the first to go down that path. You know, they very quickly signed on with abortion rights, as if there were not two separate people involved in an abortion, you know, the mother and the child. And so now they've just continued to go down this path of following whatever the latest sexual revolutionary progressivist fad happens to be. And so it's a longstanding pattern, and it bears some looking at.
Well, you know, I remember seeing advertisements from the 1950s. In retrospect, I'm not that old, but it was, you know, 4 out of 5 doctors smoke Lucky Strikes, or doctors recommend Camels. I think they were just taking money. But this is something different, isn't it?
Yes. And to be fair, back in the 50s, it was possible at least to not be sure of the impact of smoking on lung cancer or health. It was possible to not know. It's not possible to not know that this is a bisexual species, you know, that we come in male and female, and our whole bodies are affected by whether we're male or female, and that there are really only two. It's not possible to be unaware of this fact. And so I think what has happened, we had several, at a recent convention, we had several speakers who were physicians talking about the corruption of the medical profession. And one of the points one of them made was that this was the guy who was part of the American College of Pediatricians, talking about how the American Academy of Pediatrics became corrupted. And what he had to say is that originally the academy was doctors, but it became dominated by academic doctors, research doctors, people who should be the most scientific. But in fact, because they were more or less, not completely immune, but they were kind of at an arm's length from actual patient care and more involved in research, it was easier for them to get drawn into academic fadism and stuff like that.
Okay.
And I think that's what's happening here with the AMA as well. There's less hands-on doctoring at the top of this professional organization and more academic speculation, you could say. I think that's a part of what's going on there.
Friends, I'm speaking with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're beginning our timely Tuesday talking about the American Medical Association removing the identification of sex at birth certificates. Curiously, the State Department apparently is not committed to following the science because you don't have a none of the above option when you're applying for a passport. What should this do to the emerging cult of the expert? You know, someone with a lab coat comes on and he's got a government job, and we're meant to rearrange our lives because science. Shouldn't that make us scratch our head when something as obvious as it's a boy or a girl is suddenly up for grabs?
Yes, yes. And it's not just science, it's experts, you know. It's a kind of technocratic elite that are running everybody's lives. So it applies not only to medicine, but also to scientific research of all kinds, you know. I was talking to somebody who was involved in the research on abortion and breast cancer, on the link between abortion and breast cancer. And, oh, my goodness, the contortions that people tie themselves up into in order to avoid the fact that there is a link there. And that cover-up, that dodging of the evidence, that's been going on for a long time. He was telling me it's been the first paper came out of Japan in the 50s. Mm. In the 50s, there was a paper, you know. And as soon as Roe v. Wade happened, 1973, man, nobody's allowed to talk about it anymore. So this whole business of political correctness, before it was even called political correctness, you know, it was already affecting the professions and affecting science itself, you know.
You know, I find that the history of these things fascinating. When I first started to do research and preparing to teach medical ethics back in the late 90s, I saw some of the discussions regarding the loosening of abortion restrictions in the 1950s. And we were told in the 1950s that abortion is an intrinsically safe procedure and only the very best doctors do it. And then it shifted into the back alley and the coat hangers and the so on. But first they needed to overcome people's reticence. No, it's intrinsically safe. There's nothing wrong. Top men are doing this. Nothing to worry about. And then it began to shift. It's like if you look into the history of oral contraceptives back in the 50s, there were trials being run simultaneously for men and women. One man complained of the slight shrinkage of one testicle, and that was it. They canceled the study. No more. First round of trials, several women died. Oh, well, I guess we need to adjust the dosage. Hey, let's go where there are fertile women that don't go to college because their fathers have lawyers. And they started bribing poor women in Puerto Rico, take this pill and we'll give medical care to your family. There is a very bloody, misogynistic history to the contraception and abortion industry. Why don't more people know about this?
Well, you are so right. First of all, let me agree. And you very kindly mentioned my book, The Sexual State, at the beginning of my introduction here. You may remember the longest chapter in that book is called Propaganda for the Contraceptive Ideology. And the propaganda includes all of these cover-ups, you know, all of these distortions of the science, all of these suppressing of information and stuff like that. So there's that whole aspect of it, just the scientific untruth. And then the fact that, yeah, women are pretty much disposable in this whole thing and have been for a long time. The Puerto Rican women you're talking about, who were the subjects, you could say, of the first round of testing, extensive testing, many of them quit taking it because they hated the side effects. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's still the case that women, you know, the United Nations and all these people are all over the world trying to get poor women to take the pill. And the ladies are like, you know, no, I've had enough of this. And they don't want to take it anymore. You know, so if you look at the discontinuance rate, you know, it's pretty high. It's like 40%. People stop using it. And yet they continue to say, well, if only we could get more women to take contraception, we could stop all these unwanted pregnancies, all these unplanned pregnancies, and we could end poverty, and we could end global warming, and all this kind of stuff. It's like a magical talisman, you know. Right. If we just distribute enough of these little magic pills, everything's going to be solved, you know.
That's right.
It's really it's quite shocking. And the other thing that you said that just I did not know this particular thing, but I'm sure you're right. when people started promoting contraception, what they said, Father, what they said in the 30s, starting in 1935 in Connecticut, when they were promoting the relaxation of the Connecticut's contraception laws, they said, oh, all we want to do is make contraception legal for married women with serious health problems.
That's all we want to do.
And the poor people, the regular working class Catholic immigrants are like scratching their heads like, are you kidding me? That can't possibly be true. You can't keep that genie in the bottle. What are you talking about?
Dr. Morse, I want to talk about something positive for a change. I know it's unlike me. It's only because I haven't had enough coffee this morning. The Ruth Institute put out a press notice recently about Bishop Burbage he's the ordinary of Arlington, Virginia, and he did something that you and I would approve of. Fill us in on that, please.
Well, he issued a statement. I forget the exact title of this statement, but it was like an 8-page statement on the gender ideology.
Right.
And basically laying out the Catholic position, an authentic Catholic position on the gender ideology, and trying to provide guidance for parents, teachers, pastors on how to deal with this increasing problem. And among the things he says there is he talks about the fact that nobody's born in the wrong body, and that there are lots of ways to be a boy or to be a girl, right? And that it's not charity, it's not helpful to indulge somebody's delusion or to indulge somebody in by using their quote preferred pronouns or to call them by their new name and things like that. And it didn't read like, okay, these are the marching orders for the Diocese of Arlington Catholic Schools. It didn't read like that, but it will no doubt stiffen the spines of the Catholic educators in the Diocese of Arlington. No doubt at all that that's what it's going to do, and probably what it was designed to do, to be honest.
Well, I hope it'll bring some clarity, too, because here's, you know, I have friends in very many Catholic schools across the country, and we often get something like this. Job one of a Catholic school is to make everyone feel safe. That is job one. And there are two things we need to recognize. Number one is, I was born that way does not apply to being male or female. I was born that way only applies to sexual orientation. Whereas being male or female, that's fluid. It's indefinite. It's a moving target. And if you're not fully on board with that, someone might not feel safe. And then you are somehow responsible for violence and hate and making Jesus cry, etc. Something must have gone very wrong for Catholic schools to be in that position. Have you heard similar stories, or do I just talk to dark, cynical, brooding people like myself?
Oh no, we hear, I'm sorry to say, worse than that. That there are Catholic high schools where there are gay straight alliance clubs. I personally know of one case where at her daughter's Catholic high school, that her experience at the school is what drove the daughter down the path of gender transition. And it's just an awful, awful thing. And this is a person, I have interviewed this person on my program, the Dr. J Show. Mm-hmm. And this is a mother who prefers to remain anonymous for a whole bunch of reasons that you can probably imagine what they are. But the fact is, it was at a Catholic school where her daughter got this, you know, start down this path, down this very dark path. And, it's really quite awful. So to see Bishop Burbage coming out with this very clear teaching with a really full-throated natural theology, that's probably not the correct word. You can straighten me up, but a natural law. Realist philosophy, that's the word I'm looking for.
Right, right, yes.
Grounded in realism, grounded in the truth, that conforming yourself to the truth is the path to authentic happiness, and that everything else is going to be an illusion and harmful to you in the end.
Right. 2 points of clarification. Of course, anyone who's listening, we're not calling for violence or hate against anyone. That's not what we do.
No,
second thing to notice is while it's true that the Catholic faith acknowledges mystery, it also acknowledges the obvious, that God made us male or female and made male and female for each other for a particular purpose that has physical, moral, social, spiritual, civilizational, eternal import. And that's woven into the very fabric of the church, who's depicted as Christ the bridegroom and the church the bride. If you start to tamper with those, that nuts and bolts, that, you know, at the level of zeros and ones, to use a computer image, the whole fabric begins to fall apart. Now, I can wax eloquent on the theological import, but you've been studying these matters on the practical and social level. What have you been finding now that we've been tinkering with the obvious for so long? What has some of the fallout been?
Well, you know, one of the, not so much the fallout, but the on-ramp, what has led up to the gender ideology? A lot of times, Father, people will say to me, Dr. Morse, where did this transgenderism come from? It seems like overnight, everybody's trans and they're trans characters on TV. And where did this come from so quickly? And I want to say to them, listen, slow down. This has been going on for a long time. The blurring of gender lines, the deconstruction of the body in various ways, various forms of feminism had that as part of their understanding, that the body is not really so significant. We should, you know, we should have men and women doing the same jobs. We should have the same expectations for performance in all sorts of topics. Not just intellectual topics, but all sorts of topics. We should demand equality between men and women. In many ways, that move has been underfoot for a long time. And the second thing that I think is even more momentous is the whole impact of the contraceptive ideology, because the male and female that you've just spoken about, the natural purpose of us being male and female is to procreate. And that's what, you know, you don't want to say that's what the body is all about, but the sex of the body has built into it the capacity for reproduction.
Right.
And so periodically people will say, well, what about the intersexed people who are not exactly all male or all female? Well, the interesting thing about the intersexed people, and this was pointed out to me by Dr. Michelle Curtella, they are almost inevitably sterile. Their reproductive organs are not properly ordered to their proper end, right, which is reproduction. Mm-hmm. Their reproductive organs, because of the disorder of development, sexual development that they have, they can't do what the reproductive organs are supposed to do. Right. And so to hold them up as exceptions that somehow prove that there's no such thing as the sex of the body, or that the socially constructed gender is more significant than the bodily reality, that's a complete misunderstanding, and we got there by our denigration of procreation and our refusal to take it seriously.
Friends, I'm speaking with Dr. Jennifer Roebuck Morse of the Ruth Institute. Do check out her important book called The Sexual State. Dr. Morse, I believe firmly that once you separate sexuality from fertility, then that's a hand grenade at marriage, and once you shatter the idea that male and female made for each other, the begetting of children towards not only preparing civilization, but ultimately bringing about citizens of heaven. Once you take away the fundamental building block, isn't it the case that any other limit you put is just arbitrary? So if we're really going to be pro-life, and we'll talk about this more in the next segment, if we're really, really going to be pro-life, don't we have to be pro-male, pro-female, and pro-marriage, which means also not only against abortion, but against contraception?
I absolutely think that that's true. And I think that there are too few in the pro-life movement who are willing to take that step. They're freaked out. You know, they're scared to go there. But Pope Paul VI, God rest his soul and God bless him, when he came out with Humana Vitae, he was trying to help us. He was trying to protect us. And in many ways, people did not expect that particular pope to say that particular thing. You would almost think the papacy was protected by God from error. When you think of all of the temptations that he had, you know, to rule incorrectly on that topic. But the fact is, what he said turned out to be completely validated by events. Let's put it that way. And to be pro-life, we really have to be pro-marital sex, pro-marriage, pro-male and female, and to see the whole big picture as an issue of justice for children, that that children have a right to their own parents, and they have a right to be loved and known by their parents, in addition to having the right to live in the first place. You know, all of that is a, you could call it a seamless garment.
Right. And if you wanted to talk about pro-family policies, maybe, I'm just spitballing here, we could have a tax structure that did not disincentivize the formation of families and small businesses to support families. Does that sound crazy? Am I just raving? Do I need more coffee to calm down?
I don't know if you need more coffee, but no, that's not raving at all, Father. As you know, we have way too many public policies and social practices that disincentivize married sex and married childbearing, and that incentivize non-marital sex and non-marital childbearing, all of which is an injustice to children.
We've got about 2 minutes left in this segment. I'm going to ask you an impossible question to address in those 2 minutes. Why the rage against childbearing? Where does that come from?
The rage against childbearing? Oh, right. Well, you know, we've had, for my entire adult life, we have been propagandized with the idea that there are too many people in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And that propaganda comes directly from a not very large group of very, very rich people who, for whatever reason, believe there are too many people in the world and believe it's their God-given right and responsibility to do something about overpopulation. And that's just a fact, that the Bill Gateses of the world, before Bill Gates, there was John D. Rockefeller the third. There was Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett, most people don't know this, Warren Buffett has given over $1 billion to abortion-related causes.
Oh.
Okay. And also George Soros. You know, a lot of people know George Soros is a bad dude or whatever. You know, a lot of people are aware of him and Bill Gates. But there are lots of other very rich people who, you know, who I don't know exactly how their minds work. I honestly don't. But we know what they say. And what they say is there are too many people, environmental degradation, blah, 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 blah. Well, if you live like Al Gore and fly around in a private jet and have a 10,000 square foot home, yeah, okay, if everybody lives like that, maybe you've got an overconsumption problem. But that has nothing to do with whether a woman in Nigeria should be worried about having a fourth child. If she wants a fourth child, she should be allowed to have as many children as she wants.
Yes, indeed.
It has nothing to do with it, you know? Right. So, you know, once again, I think the Catholic Church has been on the right side of history, quite in spite of all of the pressures to conform to the spirit of the age. The doctrine remains intact.
Dr. Morse, we had a big breakthrough in the pro-life drama last week. The Supreme Court allowed to stand and go into effect a heartbeat law in Texas that has a distinctive feature. Could you fill us in on that, please?
Well, the idea is that abortions are banned once you can hear the little baby heartbeat. And this is going to have probably a zillion legal challenges, but the significance of the Supreme Court's decision is that the law is permitted to take effect even while the challenges are ongoing. And they didn't have to do that,
right?
And a lot of cases, they do the opposite of that. They go, oh, well, you know, we'll wait and see. So, no, you can't do it. But, no, they've allowed it to go into effect. And the whole sexual revolutionary establishment has, I would say, lost its mind over this. You know, they're collectively carrying on, you know. So
I think the social scientists would say they decompensated. It's been fascinating to see, hasn't it, that the thoughts of many are being revealed.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Yeah, and, you know, one of the things that was jumped out at me, you know, as an economics professor and stuff, is the people who have a vested monetary interest in abortion were the first out of the gate, man. The people who create the mobile dating apps basically were right on top of it, you know, saying, we're going to give money to Planned Parenthood so that women can leave the state of Texas to have their abortions because, you know, by golly, this directly affects our business. And I'm like, yeah, you know, it actually does affect
our
business.
They can ride in cars provided by Lyft, L-Y-F-T.
Yes.
Isn't that interesting?
No, I did not know. See, it came out in one of those articles, Father, that Planned Parenthood has a contract with Lyft so that if a woman needs a ride home from the abortion clinic, Planned Parenthood will call a Lyft for them. And I suppose, I don't know if they pay for it or subsidize it or whatever they do. But they already have a business relationship with Lyft to transport women home from their abortions when they don't have anybody to help them. Okay, that's an interesting thing to have come out, you know, that they're paying for people's transportation. They're not paying for people's child care for them to be able to take care of their kids, which is what crisis pregnancy centers do, you know, help you take care of the child. They'll help you get home. And it shows how many women have no one with them to help them, to back them up.
Right.
They're on their own, you know?
Right.
And this is what Planned Parenthood is subsidizing. So that kind of came out of this whole cloud of outrage, you know?
What I notice is that there seemed to be tremendous clarity and tremendous fog at the same time. The fog is, and I've seen this on social media, it's just a blob of cells thing. And I said, well, if it's just a blob of cells, then it can't have a heartbeat. But the other is now is said, hey, apparently being male or being female really makes a difference. Remember that this summer or this spring, you know, you didn't say Happy Mother's Day. You said Happy Birthing Person's Day. You know, they were putting feminine hygiene products in the bathrooms of the boys' bathroom and high schools, et cetera, because not only women menstruate, but now all of a sudden, unless you have a uterus, you have nothing to say about abortion. There are people walking around with hand-drawn signs with the female reproductive system saying, don't tread on me. Doesn't it strike you as odd that when it comes to the transgender ideology, being male or female doesn't matter, but when it comes to abortion, being female is absolutely decisive? Can those two be reconciled?
No, of course they can't be reconciled. And that is why we have the very interesting phenomenon of some of the most radical feminists being absolutely dead set opposed to the whole transgender ideology.
Mm-hmm.
There's even a mean label that the trans activists have created. It's called TERFs, Trans Exclusionary Radical Feminists. Okay, and so if somebody calls you a TERF, that means they hate your guts because you actually believe that there is such a thing as women and that women have rights and that we don't want people with male bodies coming into our lesbian film festivals or rape crisis centers or women's prisons. You know?
Exclusion, that's one of the four sins that cries out to heaven for vengeance, isn't it? Or maybe my memory is a little off.
Sins against what heaven?
Friends, I'm talking with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking in this segment about Texas and the new abortion law. Dr. Morse, one of the canards that's raised against pro-life advocates is you only want to oppress women and you only want birth to be achieved and you care nothing about woman or child after that. You've heard that too, I'm sure, haven't you?
Oh, criminy. Of course. That's constantly. Mm-hmm. Yes. What about it?
It happens to be not true.
It happens to be not true. Yet another point that happens to be not true.
Right. Right. Yeah. And I think as a part of a specifically Christian, really Catholic response to the issue of abortion, look, there really are women in distress. I mean, if you don't have, you know, when you have to depend on Lyft to take you home from your abortion, and that's played by Planned Parenthood, that's a real indication that a woman has been abandoned. That she is in isolation, she's in desperation. And given what I know about human nature and also spiritual warfare, when you're in distress and you're frightened and you're convinced that you have no choice, that's the worst possible time to make a life-altering decision. And it seems to me that the real predators here are not only the men who impregnate the women and abandon them, but also the ones who exploit them on the other side by killing their children. So what would a properly pro-woman, pro-child, if you will, seamless garment ethic of life begin to look like in your view?
Well, before I answer that, let's just point out that the fact that people are shocked over guys like Andrew Cuomo sexually harassing and abusing women, people are shocked over that because, after all, he's pro-woman. He's pro-abortion. Well, you and I have no trouble understanding that. A guy who thinks he's entitled to do what he wants sexually with any woman within hand's reach, that's a guy who needs abortion as a backup plan. Mm-hmm. And this rhetoric that the so-called feminists have cooked up for us is providing cover for those guys. So, you know, it should be coming into focus for people that what we've been calling pro-woman is not pro-woman. Now, to your question about what does a consistent, you know, pro-life seamless garment kind of thing look like? What it looks like is support for women and children before, during, and after their pregnancy. That's what the whole network of pregnancy care centers has been designed to do. That's what they're there to do. They're there to provide counseling, health care in some cases, ultrasounds in some cases, baby clothes, diapers, formula, parenting classes. I mean, most of these centers are there from the time you walk in to the clinic saying, I think I'm pregnant. For a year later, they're helping. Mm-hmm. For a year after the birth of the child, they will provide services to that person. And what do we have the so-called pro-choice people doing? We have them attacking the pregnancy care centers and the pregnancy care movement. We have them attacking the thing that actually gives women authentic options and choices and hope.
What's the nature of their attack? What does that look and sound like?
So there have been several states, Father, that have tried to place restrictions on these centers. For a while, there was a rule in California that if you were a pregnancy help center, you had to have a big sign up there that as soon as you walked in the door, it said, we don't do abortions. Here's where you can go to get an abortion. That finally got thrown out, I think. I hope that got thrown out. But that's what the state legislature of California wanted, right? They say these centers mislead women. These centers shame women. They don't give them authentic choices. And I'm thinking to myself, if you're pregnant, you walk into one of these places, let's say you're 4 months pregnant, you walk into one of these places and you figure out it's not an abortion clinic. Okay, you were maybe confused when you walked in. You can very easily walk out and find an abortion clinic. You can do that very day. You can do it the next day. You can do it any day through the entire course of the pregnancy. And your baby will be gone that very afternoon.
Right.
Very afternoon, the baby will be gone. If you are going to trick women into having a baby they don't really want, you got to trick her every single day.
Right.
You know, because that decision has to be reaffirmed daily. Whereas the decision to abort is not like that. It's one and done, man. And so that whole line of argument, it's horrible. It's just, it shows how low the pro-abortion forces have stooped, that they would talk like that and expect anybody to buy what they're selling.
Well, that's the thing. It was interesting to see is, you know, these weren't just business people being concerned about their bottom line. I mean, the rage that we've seen, and then the usual you know, network of Hollywood people and Washington D.C. people, the vitriol, even among politicians who are proud to talk about their Catholic identity. One very prominent former presidential candidate who claimed to have been praying the rosary every day for years said, I'll shove my rosary down your throat if you doubt my Catholic authenticity. Among such people is the promise to bring the full weight of the federal government against the state of Texas. This suggests to me, Dr. Morse, this isn't rational. I think that there's a very strong spiritual component to this rage. What do you think?
I agree with you, and I think one of the proximate causes of it is the guilty conscience.
Mm.
In other words, if you think about it, St. Paul tells us that the natural law is written on the heart.
Right.
And we do a lot to suppress that. We do mm-hmm. a lot to suppress it. But the fact is we can't completely suppress it, right? Because it keeps rearing its head, you know?
Yes.
And so if you really believe, number one, that abortion was A-okay, and number two, if you really believe that there was no such thing as right and wrong, which a lot of people claim they believe, if that was really true, you wouldn't be the slightest bit worried by somebody saying, hey, I don't agree with you.
Right.
But the fact is, they're outraged when somebody disagrees with them. They don't want to discuss it. They don't want to have an argument. They don't want to hear what you have to say. You have pricked their sense of themselves as a good person. Right. That's what the guilty conscience is saying. It's saying, I'm not really such a good person as I hope to be or thought I was or want you to think I am. And of course, all that gets all jumbled up, you know, in the confused mind that we have. So I really think that the guilty conscience is probably the biggest spiritual issue that we deal with at the Ruth Institute, you know, because it's everywhere. When you think about it, it's everywhere.
Yes, of course. You know, a right and wrong really is written in our human heart because God is provident and wise and good. And once you see that people do have real choices, that, you know, your abortion was not inevitable, that's a bucket of cold water on the soul. And if you're not convinced of the mercy of God, then that truth is almost unbearable. Dr. Morris of the Ruth Institute, God bless your good work. Thank you for being a splendid guest yet again, and I look forward to our next conversation.
Thanks so much for having me.
You've just been listening to Dr. J talking with Father Robert McTeague on the Station of the Crosses, The Catholic Current, about gender, peer pressure, bullies, and truth. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.